Okay. So what's the right answer? Almost everyone got this in the last lecture. Let's just see what everyone said. B, 69%. That is the correct answer. And we can see it from the equation that if our wavelength is shorter, this frequency is longer. And it's just linear in the sense that if this goes twice as short, this goes twice as long. Very good. In fact, this is the pattern. This graph shows the pattern of waves that you can get on a string of a fixed length L. And you can do this. If any of you are guitar players, you're probably very familiar with this, right? How many guitar players in the audience? Just, only a handful, about 10%. No doubt you use these, what we call harmonics, to tune your guitar. So we saw that the longest wavelength, and hence the lowest frequency we can get, is 2 times L. The next one is L, and that's by tuning this up to from 13 to 26. See if that works. So that's the N equals 2 pattern here. That corresponds to the second harmonic. It has a frequency twice as great. I'm controlling the frequency. L is fixed. And the wavelength you can just see from the pattern that you get. Now if we go to 39. You can see we get a pattern with 3 maxima, 3 antinodes. And it has a frequency 3 times bigger than the fundamental frequency, etc. So it's an easy one to remember that the frequency just goes as the nth harmonic. So if n equals 1, that's the fundamental. And we know what f0 is. We can calculate it if we know what the length L is. So you can imagine all sorts of fun problems that we can do with this. There's a general expression for the wavelength lambda is 2L divided by n. Remember, we start with 2L because you have to go twice L to go through one full wave cycle in space, in the spatial dimension. Now, I'd like you to contrast this with the very different situation you get for wind instruments, which create waves in a tube, usually with one end open. You can also have waves in a tube with both ends open, but we're not going to talk about that in this course. Now, in this case, very different situation. What do you have? There are air molecules, and we saw a nice animation of this in the last lecture, which are able to slosh in and out the open end of the tube, which is open to the atmosphere, and so the pressure is staying constant, atmospheric pressure there. They slosh in and out, but they can't move at the closed end. They run up against the closed end of the tube. And so there can be no displacement of the molecules in the air at the closed end. Therefore, the closed end of the tube has to be a node of this standing wave pattern. And we will set it up so that we have an anti-node at the open end and a node at the closed end. That's where you can get the maximum displacement and have a standing wave pattern. And you could actually model this as a pressure wave or displacement wave going in and another one reflecting off it coming out. So the tricky bit here then is, what is the next highest frequency that you can get? Well, if we move this antinode, this maximum, inside the tube, we have to go all the way 3/4 of a way through the full wave cycle in order to get the next antinode at the open end of the tube. And if you work it out, that corresponds to a wavelength of 4L divided by 3. And you can see that the wavelength is just 4 of these. There are 3/4 waves inside the tube and one imaginary one outside. So the wavelength corresponds to 4/3 the length of this tube. Very strange. And you keep going with the odd numbers. 4/5 for n equals 5. 4/7 for n equals 7. And there is no n equals 2 or n equals 4 or n equals 6 in the case of an open-ended tube. All right? Nevertheless, just to confuse you and keep you on your toes, we call n equals 3 the second harmonic, n equals 5 the third harmonic, etc. And, you know, that's a bit of a strange thing, but you will get used to the idea. As long as you just remember that for one end open, one end closed, you have that the wavelength is 4L over N, and N is an odd integer. That's the rule. Definitely something you're going to want to have on your cheat sheets, right? Is the draw these pictures for yourself on your cheat sheets. I would highly recommend just making these diagrams. And then you'll really, you know, it'll sort of tend to embed it better in your brain. Now, there's another very interesting phenomenon that can occur when we have two waves adding. Everything we've done so far, we're adding two waves that have the same frequency and wavelength, right? But we don't have to. We can always add two different waves with two different frequencies. To make it easier to think about here, we'll give them the same amplitude. And for sound and air, they have the same velocity, right? So that's good. Now, in this case that we've drawn here, we're adding a 50 hertz wave, 50 cycles per second, to a 60 hertz wave. That's a very low tone that you can kind of barely hear. And the resulting wave, once you work through, you know, sine A plus sine B, you're going to find that you have 2 sine 1/2 A plus B and cosine 1/2 A minus B. Well, that's interesting. If we, what it shows you is that there is there are two components that are multiplying, one of them related to the difference in frequency of the waves. So in this case, we have 50 hertz and 60 hertz. We have a component which is related to the sum of the two hertzes, 110 over 2, so there's something like 55 hertz inside this envelope, which is going at a frequency of the difference, which is 10 hertz. Now, you've heard this phenomenon before, I'm sure. But I have to do a little bit of rewiring here to demonstrate it. Let's see, I put that there, one of these here. One of these here, turn them. You hear that kind of fast la 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 thing going? The two speakers are putting out slightly different frequencies. And you can tune how fast or slow that goes if I'm careful. Now it's slower, right? La la la. You hear the beat? Okay. Are you annoyed yet? All I was doing is changing the frequency of one of them. If it matches on, then they stay in phase. If they're off by a little bit, then they go in and out of phase. And that's what you're seeing here. The places where you have the maximum is where the peaks are tending to line up. The places where you have the minimum here is where the valley of one is lining up with the peak of the other one. They're tending to cancel. So it's going in and out of canceling or adding constructively. And what you hear, that la 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 sound, is the envelope, and the envelope corresponds to the difference in the frequency. So in the case where we have 60 hertz added to 50 hertz, the difference is 10 hertz, so you would hear 10 of these envelopes hitting your ear every second. So let's do a clicker question. Lightning clicker question. Which is basically, were you listening on the last slide? Two musicians try to play a concert A, 440 hertz, while tuning up. One or both of the musicians is off a little bit, and a beat frequency between their tones of 2 hertz is heard. Their possible frequencies are what? What set of 2 frequencies could give you a beat frequency of 2 hertz?